Welcome to Plastering School Part 2. Now, today we're going to be doing some pebble dashing. On here we've got a scratch coat of sand and lime. That's purely so we can knock the whole lot back off once the demonstration's been done and use the block work again. On one side of this we're going to put a scratch coat of a 3:1 sand and cement mix without waterproofer. The other half, we're going to put a 3:1 sand and cement mix with waterproofer. Then they're going to be left overnight. When they're dry, we're going to put a second coat on across the whole lot and dash it. And you'll see the results of waterproof backing and a non-waterproof backing. Okay, if you know your background's going to be very porous, and it's always sensible to wet it down a little, otherwise no matter what you put on there, if it dries out too fast you won't be able to control the gear and you can get some really chronic cracking. So what we have here is our 3 sand to 1 cement mix. It's a strong mix, but that's good for a first scratch coat, especially when you're dashing. Now on this first part of the wall, we're going to put our scratch coat without the waterproofer. By now you would have been practicing with your practice coat that we were using in Plastering School Part 1. So you should have your trowel technique off to a T by now. Also, when you're doing a scratch on a wall, the best time, I'm just going to be using this spirit level for now, but the best time to straighten out your wall is with your scratch coat. So you'll get your coat on there, you'll use your straight edge. To flatten that out. Don't ever let a carpenter see you use a stabilizer spirit level for ruling off sand and cement. Any hollows there, you can fill in. Again, if you get most of your level out on your base coat, then your second coat can go on as tight as it needs to be without having any hollows in it. Okay. I'm little scratch in there. And now in our cement mix, we'll do the addition of the waterproofer. Okay, so the coat we're now going to add to this side has got a waterproof liquid additive added to it and been mixed in. The purpose of this demo isn't really about the ruling off so much as it's about showing you how a waterproofing agent should be used and when it should be used. Again, the technique for putting on a render coat, if you're right-handed, you would normally work from top right and go towards the left and down. But for this demo, it's just a case of me getting it on there. To show you. The results we'll have when we come to do our dashing coat. And grab your scratcher. Put your key, the mechanical key, on there. Okay, gonna let this dry now overnight. For you, we'll be back in a few seconds and we'll put our thin coat over the top and we'll dash it and we'll see how we get on. Okay guys, also before we crack on, I just want to go through a few angle beads, the most common angle beads that are used when you're plastering. Now when you're using plasterboard, going around the plasterboard corner on a wall, you use the plasterboard bead. They're quite thin, they can be screwed on if you can get a fix in, but oftentimes they'll be planted into the plaster, whether that plaster is finish or bonding. And leveled up, because you don't always get a perfectly straight bit of plasterboard work or a completely straight bit of wall, so sometimes it's best to butter up that corner first with some finish or some bonding and then push your bead into that, level it up so you're ready to go. Apart from the corner bead, you also get plasterboard stop bead, so there's no return on this apart from that very small lip on the end there. So rather than having to go around a corner of any kind of surface, like on this for example, up there with a corner bead covers you for plastering the top and the front on any particular wall, whether it's inside or outside. The stop bead, so for example, you don't need to touch the top of this, so you don't want a bit of metal bead showing at the top on any kind of wall. That's when you'd use a stop bead. That would make your edge, so you would have your plaster So on the front edge, or it can be done from the opposite way, bed that into the plaster, and then that is your finished edge when you plaster up to that, to give you a nice clean edge. If you need a clean edge and you're trying to do it freehand, they never look great, and it's not a very strong edge, whereas obviously any metal bead gives you a nice strong edge, so if it gets tapped or knocked, it won't take chunks out of it. That's on the plasterboard front, or on the just skimming over existing walls. But of course, when you're rendering, again, inside or out, though outside you've got to be a bit careful as how galvanized these are, or whether you've paid a fortune for stainless steel ones, because they can obviously rust over a long duration, depending on whether they've got lots of paint on, and to keep them protected. Anyway, again, you've got the corner bead for doing a return. So you've got a front and a return. But again, also, as in with the plasterboard bead, you have a render stop bead. Again, basically, it's exactly the same in design as the stop bead for plasterboard, but obviously it's much bigger. And again, with something like this, if you don't need to do a return on your plaster, you just need to plaster the front of something, again, you can use then a render stop bead. Currently, these are retailing at a ridiculous price of almost practically a fiver each, all the beads at B&Q Depot. So until things improve, they're very expensive, but generally that is what you would use. On the pebble dashing that we're doing today, pebble dashing, when it's on the top part of a building and then there's bricks underneath, the finished brickwork, you don't just come down with your render and dash and just make a line and kind of stop there. Again, you put some kind of bead along the bottom. And in that case, it's one of these. It's often known as a bell bead because of the way it comes out that way. And if you had one the other way, it would be like a bell. But anyway, this has got a much larger bottom on it, so that literally once that's been bedded in to some cement, say at the bottom of your wall or where you need it to stop, because then there's going to be brickwork underneath that, in this part you make a curve with your cement, so your cement curves from the bottom of that bead and up your wall, so you're dashing as it comes down and your render comes down, comes to a nice curve and stops on that nice straight edge along the bottom. And then you've also with this basically got a drip lip, so water that drips off of this rather than running down the brickwork drips from the lip, which is fantastic. So that is the bead you need to stop the bottom of not all render, because it's only if you're doing something that where you need to stop at the bottom that it curves out and has a drip lip on it like that. Okay. Let's get some stuff on here and see how we get on. Now, if you've ever seen any concrete work done, you'll know that it's got expansion joints in it. Because basically, if there's no expansion joint, because concrete shrinks and expands, you will get indiscriminate cracking in it. So by putting an expansion joint in it, you allow some movement. So if there's going to be a crack, it tends to crack where your expansion joint is. Now, this also happens on large areas of wall. So what you would do, if you've worked out where your expansion joint's gonna be, and sometimes this is purely done just as a feature as well, which you could blame architects for, is you take your stop beads, because this is gonna be a rendered wall, or a wall that's going to have like bonding on it or whatever, if it's inside. You get the stop bead. This, for example, is going to be your expansion joint. So you would set one stop bead one side and the other stop bead on the other side to give you that gap. That gap would be your expansion joint. Let's do that just to separate these two bits of wool, the one we've done without a waterproof backing in it and the scratch coat that has got a waterproofer in it. Okay, so we put enough on there to bed in our expansion joint. Obviously you would level this up, but I'm not going to bother with that on this small demo piece. Make sure that's bedded in so the mesh goes right into the cement. Tidy that up a bit. Okay. This side. Doing the same. Sure that's pushed right in so the mesh cement comes through the mesh which holds your bead nice and sturdy. Okay, on a large wall you'd probably let that pick up a little bit while you're doing something else so that when you came to actually rendering it there's no chance of you accidentally knocking these out of place. So as you can see there, as we said, either an expansion joint because there needs to be one because you don't want a indiscriminate crack appearing on the wall, so it'll tend to follow where your expansion joint is, or literally just as a feature in a wall, these things you can bed into a wall in horizontally, vertically, just to give you something that looks a bit fancy, but quite a lot of messing about, but it's entirely up to you. Depending on what your products are. Okay, so we've got that expansion joint on there. Next, I'm going to coat up both sides, one without waterproofer, one with the waterproofer. We're going to dash it and see what happens. Okay, so we've got our gear mixed up. You'd normally do between a 4:1 and a 5:1 mix ratios. That's a 4 sand to 1 cement or 5 sand to 1 cement. You can also add lime to that, maybe put a little less cement in there, and or a waterproofing plasticizer, which I'm using in this today. Okay, let's get this show on the road. Nice coat on there, ready to take the stones. The only stones I could get hold of at the moment are a grey kind of shingle, not something you'd probably normally use when you're dashing a wall. You can buy all sorts of different types of dashes to put on the walls now, little white spar stones or your common or garden pea shingle, which I couldn't get any of that either. Okay. This again goes up to the edge of your stop bead. Again, depending on how flat you've got your wall, you still may need to rule it off, but for this demo, you won't too worry too much about that. Okay, so there's our side with out the waterproofer on the back. Also, taking into account when you're doing a wall that you're going to dash, you are going to be putting on quite a large section at a time, and you need that cement to stay nice and wet for your stones to stick. Now, this is only a small area of wall we're putting on here. Also, along the bottom of your wall, firstly, you definitely need to put some kind of floor protection down. Maybe some tarpaulin's probably your best bet. And then if you've got a scaffold board that you could lay across the bottom, that allows you to pick up stuff that you might have dropped, and it should be in a decent state that you can use it again. If you just drop it into some other bits and pieces and stones that you've got on the floor, apart from mess up the floor, you can't really scrape any of that up and use it onto your wall, because you're ruining it. Okay. Again, we come right up onto our stop bead. You can see now how the bead works to give you your expansion joint. Keep it neat up. The middle of your joint out. Beautiful. Okay, now some stones you might buy, if like you're just buying a bag of pea shingle, something like that, chances are it'll be quite dirty and dusty, and although they might look okay, you dash them on the wall and then when they actually dry off a bit, you can see they're all kind of covered in dust, which don't look great, and you don't really want to be having to like hose that off when it's dry. So it's a good idea, like I've done with these, basically I've given them a wash and rinsed them off, so they're a little bit damp, but they're not filthy. Again, if you've got a scaffold board along the bottom of the floor, because a lot of stones will bounce down and land basically on the ground where your scaffold board is, you can scrape those back off the ground. But what you want to be careful of is you don't just scrape those up and throw them back on the wall, because if they've fallen into any cement and then you throw them back on the wall, when they dry out, you'll see the cement stuck to the stones, and you don't want that either. Generally, when you're dashing, it's difficult to show you on this demo piece, but well, you normally have a scoop. Oh, here it is. And the motion tends to be you dig your scoop in and you flick up across onto the wall. So, see how that's doing. For an internal expansion joint or feature, you can use the plasterboard stop bead in exactly the same way, except you'll be putting it either side on a plasterboard wall. Again, you're probably better to set those into the plaster than put screws in there, depending on what kind of fixture you've got at the back. And you can get your screw heads getting in the way, which you don't want. Okay, left this for a little while, not very long. Got the stones to dash on. Let's crack on with that. When I dash, I tend to dash from the top downwards, but different guys have different methods. Got a bit of an issue here. They're sticking okay, well, sort of, near the expansion joint. So I think I've got the plaster a little bit thicker here. Again, this is only a small section. If you're putting on a larger section for doing dashing, it's going to be more like this than it is like this. And this is the common issue people have, even when they're doing little patches of dashing. Okay. Right, this is a side that's got the waterproof scratch coat on it. There was no PVA put on top of that. It wasn't wetted down before this coat was put on. Just waterproofer in that coat. Okay, let's try dashing that. This is doing what I told you not to, but for demo purposes. Scraping a bit back up off the floor. I think it speaks for itself. Right, This is more the result you want, other than this you don't want. So basically, all you need to remember is when you're going to dash something, your coat, your scratch coat underneath must have plenty of waterproof in it. No waterproofer in the backing. And again, if you were doing a larger area, practically all the stones would bounce off when you went back to it. The side that has got the waterproof scratch coat underneath, much, much better. Now, because we have put behind this the sand and lime scratch coat, because you want to be able to use this wall again, especially if you're using it for practicing at home somewhere, you can simply, he said, now this is still wet from our demo, but whether it was wet, the scratch coat underneath is dry. The fact that it's just the sand and lime scratch coat underneath that on your blocks, it will come back off. Now that that sand and lime coat was put on 4 days ago. The scratch coat with the sand and cement in, that was done 2 days ago, and now we've just done that coat on top for the demo for the pebble dashing. But as I said, you could also on top of this your sand and lime coat, practice with bonding, practice with finish. You can put angle beads on, and when you're done, and just take it all back off, which is quite satisfying. You could do it, but I'm doing it with this. If you've done a big area of wall, you can just go for it with a hammer, with a chisel, let a bit of aggression out on it. Basically, I won't keep doing it now because I'll make for a boring video. But oh, wrong way. Anyway, guys, thanks for watching. Thanks for subscribing. That's finally Plastering School Part 2 under the belt and in with the other videos. There will be more videos coming soon. Be careful out there and keep going at it and keep practicing. If you can get hold of some sand and some lime, practice till your heart's desire. Check out Plastering School Part 1 if you haven't already. I'll see you again soon. Take care for now. Bye.